Lord willing, I'll be able to look at just a few verses. There's verse 6 down through verse 10 is where I think I'll be able to take a look at some things. So, Book of Revelation, chapter 22. Get any farther back and you're in the concordance, right?
Yeah.
Amen. So here we are. God's word says, "And he said unto me, these sayings are faithful and true. And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done. Behold, I come quickly. Blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And I, John, saw these things and heard them. And when I had heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things. Then said he unto me, See, thou do it not. For I am thy fellow servant, and of thy brethren the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of this book. Worship God. And he saith unto me, Seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand." Let's bow together for a word of prayer. Father, I thank you again for being able to come together like this and to look into your word. And this is a precious book, and we're told at the beginning of the book of Revelation, that if we study it and meditate on it, that we get blessings. And so, Lord, as we look, we're looking so that we can tell others that the time is at hand, that it's soon that you're going to come back. And so I pray that you would just equip us to be able to go out and help others. Please, Father, move among us with your Holy Spirit, that not only the things I say, but things people see in the Word and things that they hear with their ears will go into all of our hearts so that we might love you and serve you. And so help us, and we'll thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. So we're here in the book of Revelation, chapter 22, and we've looked at so many things about all this. And we read here then at verse 6, "And he said unto me," so this... you know, and he said, if you look there, verse 1, "and he showed me," you know, these things keep going back to, you know, the fact that, an angel has been sent to show him all of these things, mm-hmm. and to measure all these things, and we see all of those things in chapter 21, verse 15, "and he that talked with me had a golden reed in his hand." You know, it's just a continuation of that, okay? And so he said unto me, "These sayings are faithful and true." So what does faithful mean?
You're going to do what you said you would do.
Okay. Well, you'll always do what you say you're going to do. That's what faithful means. And we need to learn to be faithful. Amen. That's important. It's hard for people to understand that in the day that we live in. But faithful and true, you know, true, without any error. No falsehoods in it. Now, these things are faithful and true. And, you know, and that's the book of Revelation, even though we haven't seen it happen yet, it's still faithful and true. It's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know? Now, it might not happen exactly the way Pastor Calabretta said it's going to happen, but it's going to happen the way God says it's going to happen.
Amen.
And so it's faithful and true. And this is interesting. "And the Lord God of the holy prophets sent his angel to show unto his servants the things which must shortly be done." The Lord God of the holy prophets. Mm-hmm. You know, that takes the book of Revelation and it couples it all the way back to the Old Testament.
That's right.
Okay? Mm-hmm. It couples it together. That the things that are predicted in the Old Testament, and there's some things in the prophets back there that haven't been fulfilled yet. Mm-hmm. The Jews are still looking for those things to happen. And they haven't happened yet. But they will.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the same Lord God. He hadn't changed any. People think that God changes. He never changes. He's still the same God. You know, he hasn't gotten white hair now up in heaven, and he's all, you know, shriveled up, and he's got Alzheimer's disease, so he doesn't know what he's doing or saying. No, same God.
Mm-hmm.
Same God. He's still the same. And so he sent his angel. you know, to show his servants the things which must shortly be done. Didn't Revelation chapter 1 open up with that same idea? In Revelation chapter 1, you know, verse 1 and 2, it says there, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. So God said, here's the things. He gave them to Jesus Christ, and which shortly must come to pass. And then, you know, Jesus Christ sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John. So God gave it to Jesus. Jesus gave it to the angel gave it to John. And we've got it because the Holy Spirit inspired it for us. So we've got it here. So this same kind of idea, sent his angel to show his servants the things which must shortly be done. Now, shortly, that's not talking about me being vertically challenged. You know, that's not, you know, somebody calling me a name. Hey, shortly, why don't you get this thing to, you know, somebody will get that after a while. But, you know, shortly, you know, for us, we're thinking, wow, I mean, this was written almost 2,000 years ago. You know, if John, you know, was exiled somewhere around 60 A.D., you know, man, it's almost 2,000 years ago, mm-hmm. you know, that this was written. Yeah, that doesn't seem like short. Yes?
I was thinking, you know, once the clock starts ticking, once that first prophecy of Israel being back in the land, it will happen quickly, because it'll happen within a generation.
Within a generation.
So it's going to be shortly.
Yes, yes, yes.
For us.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and we don't know if that clock started ticking in 1948 when it became a nation, or in 1967 when they actually took over Jerusalem. We don't know when the clock started ticking. But it started ticking sometime, mm-hmm. you know, in there. But the other thing to think about, what does God say about 1,000 years?
Yeah,
like
it says as a day.
Like a day. So if it's almost 2,000 years, I mean, that's only 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, if it happens in 2.5 days, that's pretty quick.
Yep.
Isn't that?
Amen.
Yeah.
God's perspective.
In God's perspective, that's pretty quick.
Mm-hmm.
Ah. So, you know, quickly, we don't know. I mean, the idea here is that we just don't know how when it's going to actually happen. Nobody can set a time or a date. You know, we don't know. It could be today.
Mm-hmm.
Could be before we get to bed tonight. Could all happen.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we don't know. So we have to always be ready.
Amen.
Thank you, Brother John. I'm glad it's over. Amen. Amen. You know, we have to always be ready, and that's the truth. So, and then verse 7, we've got, behold, I come quickly. You know, obviously, you know, the angel isn't saying that, although maybe this is the angel that's going to blow the trumpet, the angel that's going to give the shout. I don't know, maybe, but probably the Lord Jesus Christ. Behold, I come quickly.
Yeah, it's in mine, and it's got it in red.
Yeah, mine's in red, too.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, behold, I come quickly. You know? So, you know, we better be ready for that. I hope that you're looking for that.
Amen.
Every morning I look out the window and think, Lord, maybe today's the day. You know, maybe today's the day. Verse 2 of 1 John chapter 3 says, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth himself, even as he is pure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm excited. Jesus Christ could come back today.
Amen.
Wow. Amen. Wow. So, he says, come quickly. Then verse 7 back here in Revelation 22 says, blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. And of course, I could have, but I didn't read there, Revelation chapter 1, verse 3, blessed is he that readeth, Have you ever read the whole book of Revelation? Let me see your hand. Okay, that's good. Blessed is he that readeth, and they that hear the words of this prophecy. How many of you heard anybody preach on the book of Revelation? Amen. All right, you've heard the words of this prophecy. And then it says, and keep those things which are written herein, for the time is at hand. You notice that keep is in here. Keep those things. And back here in Revelation chapter 22 and verse number 7, blessed is he that keepeth the sayings of the prophecy of this book. Now, we've got some different ideas about keeping, don't we? You know, my wallet keeps some things, doesn't it? You know, keeps my driver's license in there. And my library card. Amen. Yeah, you know, keeps that in there. And it keeps some pictures of my wife and kids. Amen. Mm-hmm. It keeps them. All right? So there's that idea of keeping. You know, I'm hung on to it. You know, I'm not going to let it go. I'm going to preserve it, that kind of thing. But then the other part of keeping is that we keep everything that's said in here in the sense of, are we obeying everything that's in this book? You know, we're to keep his sayings, we're to keep what he's told us to do. You know, not just hang on to them, but, you know, actively pursue those things that he's told us to do. So the blessing here is twofold. You know, you got to have the two parts. You can't just say, well, yes, I've got the words of the book of Revelation, and I've got them sealed up, and they're still in that plastic wrap when I bought the Bible at Walmart with the little Walmart sticker on there, you know, for the price tag. I've told you, Emmanuel, you probably haven't heard this, but when I used to deliver furniture when I was studying for the ministry, you know, deliver furniture and go on into people's homes, and you'd see on their nightstand or their coffee table, they have a table in there by their living room. You know, they have a table there, and they'd have the Bible all in the plastic, you know, and still have the sticker on it. They've never opened it, but they've got a Bible in their house. Mm. You know, never opened, never read it that I know of.
Televangelists love those people who think they're Christian.
I suppose. I don't know. So, you know, so keeping it isn't so much, well, you know, we just have to preserve it, so, you know, but that's part of it, but we also have to be doing what it says, keeping those commandments. Then we get the blessing, amen, and that sort of thing. So, verse 8, and I, John, saw these things. And he said he saw these things. Take a look with me, come on, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 16. Back here just a bit, 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 16. Here's how Peter says it. He says there in 2 Peter 1, 16, for we have not followed cunningly devised fables. You know, let's see, how can we work this thing out? How can we get this thing so that people are going to, you know, fall for it and all that sort of thing? A cunningly devised fable. I think that's what's going on in our world today. Mm-hmm. We have a more politically correct term for it. We call it now disinformation. Mm. That's what they call it. Mm-hmm. You know, for we have not followed cunning disinformation, trying to trip you up. Cunningly devised fables, when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. Mm-hmm. Ooh, boy. Peter was right there. I mean, he saw him, all those kinds of things. Then you go to 1 John chapter 1, verse 1. He says this, a couple pages there, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. Can you imagine climbing around some of those places, rocky places there in Judea with the Lord Jesus Christ and being one of the apostles to help him, grab hold of his hand, pull, help him up some of those rocks? Or Peter, when he's out walking on the water and then he starts to sink, "Lord, save me." He reaches up his hand. Jesus grabbed him. They've handled him. I mean, actually touched him.
Amen.
John laid his head on his breast. I mean, touched him. Oh, wow. Yeah, I mean, just incredible. So when he says back here, "I saw," you know, with his eyes, he's not saying, "Well, I was in this, well, they gave me something there. I don't know what it was." Wow, yeah. No. He actually saw the Lord Jesus Christ. He saw these things.
Jealous.
So he says, "I saw these things and heard them." You know, and of course, he's talking here not only about the Lord Jesus Christ, but he saw these things that this angel is showing him. I mean, that had to be incredible to take in. Mm-hmm. I mean, to see the new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband, and see the, you know, the tabernacle of God with men, and to see this new Jerusalem, and this, the majesty of it, just to see all of these things, and to see heaven, and, you know, the pure river of water coming out, and the throne of God, and, you know, all these things that he's seeing. Wow. I mean, it's just overwhelming. Mm-hmm. So he doesn't know what to do but to worship. It's all he just has to worship. And so there in verse 8 he says, "And when I had heard and seen, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel which showed me these things." I mean, he's just knocked over. I mean, don't you think, folks, don't you think that if God showed up in such a way. I mean, he shows up in our Sundays and Wednesday. I mean, he shows up. And he's here even tonight.
Amen.
But
amen.
If he were to actually show us a glimpse of heaven, I mean, just something, just, you know? Or if he just came and he wrote on the wall. Ooh, I mean, he's done that before.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the finger of God writes on the wall. Mm-hmm. Do you think we'd all be just kind of, "Oh yeah, oh gosh, the finger of God, oh yes, kind of nice, oh yeah. I don't think so.
No.
I think we'd all be down on our faces, amen?
Amen.
You know, especially if he's writing the same thing again, you know?
Yeah.
About our doom? He'd have every right to, with the way America's going, but...
Right.
Can you imagine? So he worshipped. Yeah. In verse 9, "Then said he unto me, See thou do it not." See, only God gets worship. Angels don't get worship.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and there's a whole lot going on today where people are selling all kinds of angels and all this kind of thing. People have their houses all filled up with all these angels and, mm-hmm. and all that kind of thing. Angels are servants in the background. And that's what he says here. "For I am thy fellow servant,
mm-hmm.
and of thy brethren the prophets, and of them which keep the sayings of this book." You know, and angels do the bidding of God, and they bring messages to God. That's why he equates himself with the prophets there. "And of them that which keep the sayings of this book," those that do the things God says they're supposed to do. You figure those angels are ready?
Mm.
You know, they're all lined up ready. You know, I imagine it, every so often they just kind of turn and say, "Is it time now, God? You know, we're ready. You know, we know where the vials of wrath are. We're ready. We're ready to pour them out. Amen. We're ready to loose the, you know, we're ready to do it. We're ready to bind up Satan, put him in that bottomless pit. We're ready."
Amen.
Yeah, they're just willing, ready. I mean, they're just ready to do it. And so then, of course, he tells them, "Worship God." And that's who we worship.
Mm-hmm.
We worship God. And that's what we're supposed to do. And we've seen that kind of over and over. And verse 10, "And he saith unto me, Seal not the sayings of the prophecy of this book, for the time is at hand."
Ooh.
Now compare that, if you would, to Daniel chapter 8, verse 26. And then we're also going to go to Daniel chapter 12 and verse 4. But compare that, if you would, back there in the book of Daniel. And then chapter 8 and verse number 26. And we read there, And the vision of the evening and then of the morning, which was told, is true. Wherefore shut thou up the vision, for it shall be for many days. Tell them, don't let people know everything about what you've seen. Don't do that. And again in chapter 12 and verse number 16, I'm sorry, verse number 4, mm-hmm. chapter 12, verse number 4, it couldn't be 16, could it? It only goes to 13. Mm-hmm. Verse number 4, but thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. Mm-hmm. Who do we have knowledge increased?
Mm-hmm. Little wisdom, though.
Little wisdom, yeah, there's not the wisdom to go with it, but we've got knowledge increased. Mm-hmm. You know, shut it up, even to the time of the end. Whereas the Lord's saying to John, through this angel back in Revelation chapter 22, seal not the sayings, the prophecy of this book. People need to know now. They need to know what's in this book, for the time is at hand. We really don't know. We have no idea. Yeah. We all could be on our way home tonight. That trumpeted sound, the shout, come up hither, and we'd all go up. We have no idea. Mm-hmm. Absolutely none. Time is at hand. Those people all around us have no idea. They think that it's not going to happen. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
They have no idea that he's coming quickly. And they think that, oh, you know, things are just going on like they've always gone on. Mm-hmm. And that's what we see in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 and 4 here. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 3 and 4, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and said, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of creation. Yeah. Where is it?
And they're willingly ignorant and five.
Yeah, they sure are, aren't they?
Choosing that.
Yeah.
To be ignorant.
Yeah. Willingly ignorant of these things. Yeah. Where is the promise of his coming? They kind of make jokes.
Scoffing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, scoffing. They make jokes about it. Well, that'll happen about as fast as Christ coming back.
I don't know.
Not funny, really. Amen. Mm. Not for us, but the world laughs at it. Yeah, the world laughs at it. But he's coming. That's what we know. He's coming. And the book wants us to know that. Revelation chapter 22 got a lot of emphasis on the fact that he's coming. And we'll get to it. We'll eventually get to it. Before the year is out, Lord willing, we'll get to the end of the book. Amen? Mm-hmm. You know, but the end of the book there, verse 17, this is our part. And the Spirit and the Bride, Revelation 22, 17, and the Spirit and the Bride say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And who's that him? That is athirst, come, and whosoever will, let him take the water of life freely. Now, come. Even so, verse 20 tells us, you know, he which testifieth these things saith, surely I come quickly. Amen, even so, come, Lord Jesus. That's what we should be saying. Yeah, that's what we should be saying. All right, any questions or comments so far about this part of Revelation? Or really any part, but any of the things we've covered. Raph, are you laying block where you're at?
I wish, no.
No?
No, I'm using the grinder a lot.
A grinder. So tomorrow you got to grind.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Do you ever think about... You know, I might not be grinding but more than 10 minutes and the shout will happen, I'll go out of here, this old grinder will bang on the floor and I'll be gone. You ever think about that?
Honestly, I haven't thought that while I'm at work. And
mm-hmm. Yeah. Tonight, Devin, when you're doing your work, you know, think about that.
Be nice.
Be nice. Of course, some people think about it this way. Oh, I've got so many troubles, and I'm up to my head, and debt, and all this stuff. It'd be really nice if Jesus had come back and get me out of all this. I don't think that's the right attitude. No. But I long for him to come. I just want to be with him.
Amen.
Yeah.
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 Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yes.
I pray that God still continues to show grace, because there's a lot of family members of mine that aren't saved.
Amen.
You know,
amen.
Family.
If we look at the disciples' prayer, when he says, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come," I pray, I say, "Father, you know, have grace. I still would like to be an instrument to speak the word and share the love of Christ with my family."
Exactly. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
Y'all share that burden.
Yeah, we have that burden. All of us have lost family members.
Yeah. Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. And I'm glad that he is waiting. We have that opportunity. Because he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
Yeah, that just shows there's still more.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
But there is going to come a time, isn't there?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
When he's going to say, that's it.
Yeah.
That's it. Yeah. So,
amen.
The door on the ark will get closed. I don't know. Hollywood's supposed to come out with a movie, isn't it? Next week it's supposed to start showing a movie called Noah.
Oh, yeah.
It's supposed to.
Is it about Noah?
It's about Noah and the ark. It says it's based on Genesis, but they've taken a lot of license. They do say that in the ads that I've heard, so I don't know. And part of what I've heard on the radio about the ad is, you know, here's like some leader and there's a whole rabble of warriors behind him. Take the ark, you know, and so I don't know if they're going to go charging and, you know, try hacking through the door of the ark. I don't know, you know. But so who knows? You know, who knows? It's Hollywood, right? So, so you go, okay, who knows?
Not good at adding to and subtracting from.
Adding to, subtracting from, yep, that kind of thing. All right, anything more about Revelation? About the Lord coming quickly. Emmanuel saying, I hope I get to go back to Nigeria before he comes. Hey, if the Lord does have that shout, you and your wife, you'll see her on the way up.
You'll see her pushing that way.
Then you might see her quicker, You have to have that long plane ride, eh?
Amen.
All right, oh boy. All right.